They're anti-government, anti-science, and anti-Obama. They have a trifecta.
Welcome to the program. I'm your captain for this two-hour pleasure cruise, where we are dedicated to the fight and the preservation of freedom, regardless of that cost. Now, remember, shipmates, freedom ain't cheap, but we can afford it. It's tyranny that we cannot afford. All right, you want to be a part of the program tonight? Don't be shy. 646-716-7978, or you can join the captain's chat room. Now, those of you that are just tuning in for the first time, scroll down on the page you're on now, and you will see it. Now, tonight, we have a very special guest on board. I'm proud, I'm honored, and I'm very happy to have him on board tonight. Dean Tong, internationally known forensic trial expert and expert witness, or trial consultant, that is, an expert witness with over 30 years of experience. He's been on numerous television shows, radio programs, Fox News, Dr. Phil. He's been everywhere. He's the expert. He's written three books, Don't Blame Me, Daddy, Ashes to Ashes, Families to Dust, and Elusive Innocence, a survival guide for the falsely accused. He provides families and attorneys with valuable defense strategies and is one of only a few witnesses who can actually provide expert testimony on the stand. So, looks like he's on right now, so let's bring him on and let's get our freedom ship underway. Mr. Tong, are you with us, sir?
I am here. Thanks for having me tonight.
Well, I really want to thank you for coming on board the program tonight. I appreciate it, and I do know that my audience appreciates it, too. I do have a lot of audience that is in archive and a lot that listen, and most of my audience now are very young parents that they're just not used to this game. So I know that they're going to appreciate the information that you're about to give us. I believe you'll answer a lot of our questions here tonight. And there's only one way to combat anything, and that is with knowledge. So we do look forward to your knowledge tonight. Now, I do have a few questions that I know is very important to my audience, and I work for my audience. I talk to my audience. I'm very in tune with them. They call me on the phone. I've been on the phone with these people in the middle of the night. They're crying their eyes out. So I know where they're coming from. So what I'd like to do is ask a few questions that pertain to them, and then I want to let you loose and let you give us, you know, the real skinny on what is really happening here. So the first question I have, I believe you and I both know the answer, where at least I do have my theory, but I want to hear from you, the expert. Like I said, most of my audience now is a growing number of young parents that are brand new to this game. They're confused. They're stressed. They have no idea what has happened to them and why. So I guess my question for my audience is, and I want to get your take on it and see how close to your answer my theory is, but when it comes to CPS taking away the children, what really is happening and why is this happening?
Okay, well, it's a little different in every state, but for all intents and purposes, there's a similar thread that cuts through these cases in all 50 states. So it all goes back to the Mondale Act, or the Child Abuse Prevention and Treatment Act, CAPTA, from 40 years ago, 1974.
Right.
That was a law that was legislated by former Vice President Walter Mondale. And it basically empowered Washington, D.C. with defining child abuse, made it a very vague, ambiguous definition. It could be anything. It could be anything or nothing. It developed the National Center on Child Abuse and Neglect Data System, NCANS, which was basically monitored by a journal called Child Maltreatment, which tabulates all the statistics for all 50 states. Right. So all 50 states were required then to report to Washington, D.C., their number of reports versus number of substantiated cases versus number of unfounded cases. I might add the word false was not in there. By false, I mean bad faith with premeditation, with malice aforethought. Unfounded, according to Webster's Dictionary and online, means without foundation, but it doesn't mean that it didn't happen. According to the child savers, the true believers, the validators out there. So that's what happened with the Mondale Act, and of course it also developed anonymous toll-free hotlines where people could pick up the telephone and basically use it as a tool for an open invitation of malicious slander to ruin your life in a New York minute just by calling a 1-800 number here in Florida in my state. It's 1-800-96-ABUSE, where somebody can just basically have an axe to grind and get you.
Now, was that part of what was that? You know, America's Most Wanted. What was his name? Something Walsh. Didn't he have
John Walsh. Yeah, John Walsh and his son Adam Walsh, the Adam Walsh Child Protection Act. That's correct.
Right. Now,
there became subsidiary statutes: the Adam Walsh Child Protection Act, the Jacob Wetterling Child Protection Act. Megan's Law, which was 20 years ago in the mid-90s, the Sex Offender Registration List Law, a little girl, Megan Kanka, who was raped and killed by Jesse Domeniquez in New Jersey. Right. So basically what happened was there became a mindset to report. If you're in doubt, make sure you report, because if you don't report, we can nail you for failure to report. I'm talking about mandated reporters now, teachers, clergy, psychologists, psychiatrists, medical doctors, nurses, police officers. All these people fall under the umbrella as mandated reporters, therapists. So
people are just reporting out of fear then.
Basically, the statutory definition in all 50 states is a reasonable suspicion. If you have a reasonable suspicion, which is very subjective in real time, if you believe child abuse is being perpetrated, by God, you have to report it. Otherwise, we can arrest you for failure to report, and we can strip you of your professional license. So there's a double whammy there that's going to clearly cause people who are mandated reporters to err on the side of reporting. To protect their own butts. So there became a mindset based on the formulation and execution of CAPTA, or the Mondale Act, of in loco parentis parens patriae, the doctrines of in loco parentis, the doctrine of parens patriae. And basically, what does that mean? Well, that means basically the state is the parent. Washington, D.C. becomes the parent. We are a better parent than you as daddy, as mommy. And if we believe you're abusing or neglecting your kid, we're going to take that kid. And if necessary, we're going to send the kid to foster care and terminate your parental rights eventually.
No.
So that became the mindset, and it was basically rubber stamped and abdicated to in the book written by Hillary Clinton about 20 years ago, It Takes a Village. That's what that book is all about. It takes a village.
Look.
So this is our perhaps next president, who's going to be the Democratic nominee. It takes a village author.
I preach a lot. You know, the problem is, and I preach a lot about this. You know, you see something, say something. Well, yeah, you do. If you see something, yes, you have to say something. But what they don't tell you is you have to back that up with a little responsibility. Now, if you can't take one more second to make sure that what you are seeing is actually what you are seeing. See, this is another problem. They don't put common sense in legislation. Now, how do you do that? I don't know. But I mean,
I want to qualify what I'm saying by stating very clearly that child abuse does occur. It's a problem.
Yeah.
It's a problem in America, both physical abuse and sexual abuse. I don't think it's the gravity of the problem that America makes it out to be through the media. And I believe the media clearly and in a premeditated way undercuts the significance of false allegations, while it overblows what I believe is genuine child abuse, many times over. And the reason I say that is most recently Dr. David Finkelhor, who is the head of the crime lab, the children's crime lab in Durham, New Hampshire, he is the head of statistics, and puts out that child maltreatment. He did a study between 1992 and 2006, a 15-year study, on the statistics of physical versus sexual child abuse, and he saw the incidence of sexual abuse decreased by 50% between 1992, which ironically was the year that my first book, Don't Blame Me, Daddy, was published, and 2006. So there was a 50% decrease in the incidence of sexual child abuse, yet the number of reports remain consistent at about 2.5 to 3 million a year across America.
Well, I found a statistic today that from, I believe it was in 2009, according to the Department of Health and Human Services, 3.3 million reports in 2009, only 14% were substantiated, and now that number of unfounded reports is over 80%. I mean, that is insane.
And that's basically, I regurgitate that number in my book, Elusive Innocence, which was published in 2002, because the numbers were similar back then.
Yeah.
when I wrote the book in 2001. So 60 to 80% has been the hovering statistical number for unfounded or without foundation cases. The number of substantiated cases where they had confirmed evidence, either through adjudication of guilt in a juvenile court or family court or a criminal conviction, albeit plea bargain or jury conviction, were, like you said, around 50%. So anyway, to get back to the Mondale Act, the other thing it did was immunize Child Protective Services. So in other words, you cannot sue the state for money in federal court. You can sue the individual caseworkers in their personal and individual capacity, but you cannot sue them in their official capacity.
They were immune from any kind of criminal prosecution of any kind, the reporters and the investigators.
I'm referring to a civil lawsuit, a civil capacity, where a child protection worker may be negligent.
So
the Mondale Act basically gave the states, every state, federal immunity under the 11th Amendment, where you could not sue the state for dollars in federal court. So if you ever, as a lawyer or you're a pro se litigant, filed a lawsuit, let's say under 42 U.S.C. 1983 in federal court, and you use the word official, you memorialize the word official in the body of your complaint for damages, that complaint's going to get tossed. That defendant is going to get tossed, because you are referring to suing the state when you use the word official. So you have to use the word personal or individual. As persons or individuals, a child protection worker has a quasi-prosecutorial or qualified or partial immunity. They don't have a 14th Amendment sovereign absolute immunity like the state has. I have a case going on right now. It's in litigation in Alabama. And we've been in court now for over 2 years on that lawsuit, and we have a CPS worker named in that case in the body of that lawsuit, and we're still surviving.
How many lawsuits are there out there right now? Because a lot of my families that I deal with, they all want to sue. Immediately they want to sue, and they want me to help them out. I don't know how to do it.
It's not that easy. You have to first be cleared in juvenile or family court or on the state registry before you can then turn around and sue. So, you know, it's not what you know. It's not what you think you know. It's what you can prove in a court of law. And, of course, I deal with cases all the time. It's what I do for a living. So I work cases, and I've been hired in cases from all 50 states. So, you know, my mantra is, winning isn't everything. It's the only thing. But I can only help to win one case at a time. That's what I do. If folks want to sue, you first have to vindicate yourself and put yourself in a position to show that the people who were investigating you were negligent in that investigation.
And I would imagine that's very difficult to prove, right?
No, it's really not. You know, so long as you have a lawyer or someone like myself who is adept at civil rights litigation strategies and techniques, and understands the law, and can help put a complaint together and survive motions to dismiss and motion for summary judgment. So
now I
want to
put your website in my chat room here, so people can have it. Now, there's very few of people like you out there, right? I mean, you are.
I'm rather unique because I am a trial consultant, a consulting expert, where I can assist in the litigation of a case in family court, juvenile court, criminal court, administrative court, appellate court. Basically all courts concerning families and children, helping someone who doesn't have the money to hire a lawyer, a pro se litigant, or better yet, an attorney. But I also give an opinion on the witness stand as an expert. I've done that in 13 states successfully, and especially so relative to the forensic interviews of the kids allegedly abused on DVD.
Well, let's cover that real quick, because I forgot to get that in at the very beginning. You know, your background, how did you get into this business?
First-hand experience, like all of your listeners and your followers. I was hit by this myself 30 years ago, back in the mid-80s, in a very nasty divorce and custody battle. And it took, it took me 10 years. And went through, went through seven different attorneys and six psychologists and five different courts to prove a negative in my innocence. The state of Florida arrested me. They dropped charges, but, during the time, I couldn't see my kids over a year. I mean, and, I didn't have the benefit of someone like myself back in the mid-80s, but especially didn't have the benefit of the law or the science of suggestibility and psychology in my backyard on my side back in the mid-80s. There was none, you basically had to do this on the run. And it was a friggin' nightmare. So, I struggled through it. I got the state to drop the charges on the criminal. I had to see my kids chaperoned for 5 years, supervised, until I finally got to see them unsupervised.
Oh.
Never again would see them overnight, alone. Never had overnight visitation until
they
emancipated.
Were they in foster care at any time, or?
Oh no, they never were. The interesting thing in my case, the family court judge was so naive that he said he thought I molested my daughter, but in the same breath he said, clearly the wife is unfit, the mother's unfit in this case, and he actually wrote that in the court order. But yet the unfit mother was allowed to, to assume full custody.
I've heard that so many times. I can't tell you how many times that I have heard that.
I decided in 1989, 25 years ago. I decided in 1989, 25 years ago, I was going to make this my life calling, and I was going to make a difference in this issue. So I started doing my first radio show, WDBO Orlando, 25 years ago, 1989, on this very issue. We didn't have, cell phones and computers back then, and iPods and stuff that the kids have now. We had the old fax machines, we had the Brother typewriter, and we had the old landlines. But the landline, our landline was ringing off the hook by people, just like the people listening to this show. They were hit by this very issue. So I started becoming an activist and started writing. I wrote, started writing my first manuscript for publication. I got it published in 92. And, that was the same year Woody Allen was accused by Mia Farrow of child molestation. And I appeared on some national TV shows in 92 based on my first book, Don't Blame Me, Daddy. And then I just became a train wreck out of control. I mean, I was on a nonstop one-way trek to fix this broken system. And, you know, I ran for legislature here in Florida. I ran for state house in 94 when I met perhaps our next president, Jeb Bush. Met him 20 years ago when he made his first run for governor down here. Handed him a copy of my first book, Don't Blame Me, Daddy, in person.
Wow.
Yeah. And I just kept going. I was just, like I said, I was on a nonstop one-way trek to fix this broken system. I tried to work with the very government charged to protect children at risk in harm's way and jeopardy, our child protection system. I then wrote my second book in 97, Ashes to Ashes, Families to Dust. And then I got on the internet the same year, 97, with abuse-excuse.com, my website, which is now up to almost 900,000 hits.
Wow.
That's a lot of hits for one guy. I mean, I'm not trying to boast here, but that 900,000 is about the population of a major city in this country.
Right.
You know, that's a lot of people that have accessed my website, who are either trying to find out about me, what I'm all about, the information that I offer at the website, all the links that I have, all the studies that I have, the information over there. The resources I provide. So it became a situation where then I wrote my third book, was published in 2002, Elusive Innocence, and then I decided to go back and get a master's degree, which I did. And I got so busy on cases, I could only do the master's degree part-time, so it took me 6 years to finish my master's, which I did in 2006. And I've testified now in 13 states, and I've handled cases from all 50 states, and I've also handled cases from the country of Canada. But the reality is there aren't enough people out there to really help with this. This is a pervasive problem. It's in all 50 states. Some states are worse than others. But clearly, the issues exist in all 50 states. It's a system that believes children don't lie about sexual abuse, must be believed and protected at all costs. And in the same breath, I'm seeing a reverse backlash where mothers are losing custody because they're believed to have coached their kids to falsely accuse dads and fathers of incest. So clearly, the right hand doesn't know what the left one is doing. A well-meaning, well-intentioned, but misguided system.
Right.
And some of that hinges on selective studies and curriculum that the child protection caseworkers and the police officers are getting, the forensic interviewers are getting. They're not reading my books. They're not reading Dr. Stephen Cece's book, Jeopardy in the Courtroom. They're not reading Dr. Phil Lesbo's book, Tell Me What Happened. They're only getting one side of the child abuse, child sex abuse coin. And, it's the old answer the $64,000 question successfully. Why would a child say you touched her private part or her pee-pee unless it happened? So if a child says you touched her, you must have done so because the child could not think about saying something like that unless she experienced it. Well, I disagree with that because 20 years ago, many studies were published by Cece and Bruck, Dr. Stephen Cece, who's out of Cornell in New York, and Dr. Maggie Bruck, who's out of Johns Hopkins. She originally was out of McGill University in Canada. They had many studies that were published. Peer-reviewed scientific journal articles and studies that actually air on national television. Dateline in 2020, I'm talking about Monster in a Box, Mousetrap, Genital Conditioning, Simon Says, and then, of course, Dr. Debbie Poole did the famous Mr. Science study. And the essence of all these studies were that over 50% of the kids who were talking about men who were touching them sexually in private parts, they were mistaken. The kids were wrong. They were mistaken. They were in error. These weren't malicious false allegations. These were just kids who were in error. They got it wrong. What we now term source misattribution. So most of these kids were young. Most of these kids were preschoolers, you know, 3, 4, and 5, you know, and very suggestible, very impressionable. They can talk about the Tooth Fairy, Santa Claus, Peter Pan, or the Easter Bunny. They can talk about how Daddy touched me in bad places.
Now, I remember a made-for-TV movie. This was, I think, the story. It was a true story. And it happened in the late 70s or early 80s. And then when I watched this, this was probably, God, it was probably the early 1990s. And here I'm thinking that this was just an isolated incident. Well, after starting, I read one story on Justina Pelletier a year and a half ago. And I can't believe I had no idea. Most people have no idea of the magnitude of what is really happening here. And
right.
That's exactly what they did. And I want to try to get into that, the parent alienation and the coaching of children. And what this story was, it was a daycare center. It was a daycare center. And because the son, it was a mother and a son, and I think there was a daughter involved. It was like a family had a daycare center. And the son was, I think he was like 22, 23 years old, and somehow they found a Playboy magazine in his room. Well, that just blew everything up, and they were showing how these so-called psychiatrists were manipulating the children with puppets to turn against this guy and say that they were touched and they were felt and they were this, and ended up this guy had to go to jail. The mother had to go to jail, even though they got their name cleared several years afterwards. But they're not allowed to have be around children anymore. They can't have a daycare center anymore. It's gone, and people's lives are ruined because of manipulating children. Now, again, I mean, the problem that I have is these people keep getting away with it. What, I mean, other than going to you, I mean, it just seems, I mean, we've got several laws on the books. What, do we need another law? What do we really need to stop this? So if you do falsely accuse, and I do understand the reason why, I mean, look, a woman is raped, you know, she may think she's raped, and I understand that this whole theory that if you take that away, then women won't report rape, or people won't report this. I'm not so sure if I really buy that or not. I really don't. In your experience, is that true? I mean, if you took that out, where if you made a false accusation, you manipulated a child, you did anything, you know, like, because if I lie to a cop and I falsely accuse a cop of doing something, I'm immediately arrested. So, I mean, what really do we need? Can we really put an end to that? I mean, do we need another law? Do we got to just tweak the law?
Well,
do we got to fix it?
Yeah. I mean, the Mondale Act, I mean, Dr. Richard Gardner, before he passed away, he was the author of the parental alienation syndrome 30 years ago. You know, Gardner wrote to the legislature in Washington, D.C. to repeal and abrogate the Mondale Act. You know, what we talked about when we began this show tonight.
Right.
Clearly, that law, the Mondale Act, the Child Abuse Prevention and Treatment Act, CAPTA, people Google CAPTA, has been reauthorized by every presidential administration over the past 40 years. It's a very politically correct law. It provides the perception to Americans that Child Protection Services is doing its job, Health and Human Services out of Washington, D.C., and, of course, in my state of Florida, it's called DCF. In New York, it's called ACS. It's got a different acronym in all 50 states, but it all means the same.
Yeah.
But the bottom line is they're not doing a good job at protecting kids who actually need protection, kids dying in state custody, in foster care. A couple of kids in my own state, Bradley McGee and Corey Greer, back in the 80s and early 90s here in my state. But on the other side of the street, in the same breath, of course, it's conducting witch hunts and fishing expeditions. And a lot of that is because it doesn't do what we call source monitoring. It doesn't look at alternative hypotheses, multiple hypotheses, and other explanations for why kids are saying what they're saying. So in most of my cases, child victim hearsay cases, he said, she said, what a child said. When you have no smoking gun, you have no medical findings, you have no broken hymen, you have no bleeding from the rectum, you don't have any of that. You have words. It's a war of words. And so how do you cut through that? Well, you got to, you know, as an investigator, whether you're a cop or CPS social worker, CPI, child protective investigator, you've got to make collateral interviews. You've got to be objective. You've got to be neutral. You've got to be impartial. And, you know, oftentimes I'll find other kids in the same household with the accusatory kid, and CPS doesn't even interview those other kids. They cherry pick who they want to interview. You can't do that.
No.
Because those other kids could either corroborate or impeach the accusatory kid. And I don't know about what state you're in, but here in my state, under Florida Statute 800.04, lewd and lascivious child molestation in my state of Florida is now a life felony. So if a little kid, you know, accuses you of touching a pee-pee, you can do life in prison, and you're done. Stick a fork in you, you know, for life. Yeah, you're absolutely done. So it's not like you can fall back on a Kmart, Walmart defense plan to prove a negative in your instance. You know, you better, you know, unfortunately, you get as much justice as you can afford, and by God, you better have, you know, the best defense you can put out there.
And just for that, you know, and I've got a lot of parents too that just one complaint. That's all that's needed. You get one school teacher complained to one of my families that I work with, because she got in an argument with the school teacher because she's got four special needs children, and
right.
Special needs children are not like normal children. You can't treat them like normal children. You can't talk to them like normal children. You know they're different. So the mother was trying to explain to her about her children, and the teacher didn't like it. So the teacher made one complaint to CPS. CPS came over and immediately took all four kids. They took the other three that were in school. They took them out of class.
Yeah. You're automatically, as the parent where CPS takes the kid, you're automatically at a disadvantage as the parent, because CPS, the government, is now in your life. They have the teacher as a witness. They're going to put that kid in – they're going to take the kid to the Child Advocacy Center for a forensic interview on DVD. That's my claim to fame, to review and critique that. Then they're going to put the kid in therapy to try to buttress the kid's credibility, keep the kid focused on what's called recognition memory, with, like what you said earlier, dolls, puppets, and drawings, to reinforce the kid's memory that, in fact, what the teacher said really happened to the kid. So they also put them
on pharmaceuticals too, which is that's another
right.
side. They can't wait
right.
to put kids on drugs.
Yeah, yeah. I used to take inquiries from the Citizens Commission on Children's Rights, CCHR, down here in Clearwater, Florida, where I am. I'm in Tampa Bay all the time. But the point is, the parents are at a distinct disadvantage very quickly out of the gate, and the system is trying to validate what the teacher saw or said. You know, they don't like to lose. I don't like to lose on the defense side. But clearly the government hates to lose, and they don't want to waste resources for nothing. They want to get some type of victory out of this. So if you're arrested, they want some type of plea bargain. If they take your kid, they want you to consent to dependency, which means the kid is adjudicated dependent, which means by statute the kid's been abused, neglected, or abandoned. And, you know, you have to jump through a set of hoops with CPS to get your kid back. And even then, you still might not get the kid back.
Right.
So now, you're working uphill very quickly. If you don't have an aggressive legal team that has a real, real clue on what the heck they're doing, it can be legal suicide very quickly.
Well, how I see it is I see these agencies, these government agencies, I see them taking advantage of the law for profit, because they get federal dollars, which there's no federal dollars. That's taxpayer dollars. Let's get that squared away. But they're taking these kids for profit.
There's a colleague of mine, Glenn, here in Florida, and his mantra is follow the money. Yeah, and I agree with that in part, you know. But there are other variables that go along in this equation, such as mindset, power, and control.
Yep.
And like I said, perception. CPS wants to give the perception to Americans that they're doing their job. Mm-hmm. And they're protecting kids at risk in harm's way and jeopardy. And obviously the sexual abuse allegations are the coup de grace, the Mercedes-Benz of the allegations, because they're the most reprehensible, heinous allegations.
Right.
So those are the ones that are going to, you know, raise a judge's eyebrows right off the judge's forehead. So you're automatically presumed guilty. Welcome to Dean Tong and the work that I've been doing for 30 years. Because when you're automatically presumed guilty, by God, you better have a plan to prove a negative in your innocence pretty quickly. I do. Most lawyers don't. With all due respect to the attorneys out there, they don't get this stuff in law school. This is not taught in law school. My books aren't in law schools. Dr. Cece's books aren't in law schools. So all the books on the false allegation side, whether it's Brenda Scott, Out of Control, Richard Wexler, Wounded Innocence, my book, Elusive Innocence, Mary Pride, The Child Abuse Industry, back from 1986, almost 30 years ago. None of those books are going to be in law schools for attorneys to go over. So any lawyer that tells you they're an expert in this field and I don't know them, chances are they're not. Because, I've been doing this personally and professionally now for 30 years.
Well, you just answered my next question, and my next question was going to be, you know, a lot of attorneys, they have specialized fields, you know, corporate, divorce attorneys, this attorneys, that attorneys. So obviously there are no real attorneys that handle this. I mean, are there? I mean, I'm sure there's got to be a couple.
That's not true. I mean, obviously I have a select few that I've worked with over a decade in my work, and I've been doing this professionally since 1994 for 20 years.
Yeah, but it's how many that are,
I have a couple of lawyers that if I was accused, again, God forbid, these are the lawyers that I would want to represent me, you know, and I would hope that the client, assuming I'm engaged into the case as a consulting expert or testimonial expert, that the client would also engage the attorney that I recommend. There's a section at my website, How to Choose Your Attorney. There's a section in my book, Elusive Innocence, How to Choose Your Attorney. I work with lawyers 24/7, 365, so I have a pretty good feel for a lawyer who's trying to bamboozle the client and just take the retainer check, or who really knows what they're doing and is willing to strike a marriage with me, work with me, understanding they probably can't win the case without me, and this is how it's going to work. We all establish a fiduciary relationship, the three stooges, if you will, myself, the attorney, and the client.
Wow. So it looks like we've got a caller online that has a question. Would you like to take a question?
Absolutely.
Okay, let's bring her on. Okay, now, I don't have your name on my system here, so I'm just going to read the last four digits of your phone number. It's 7732. If that's you, you're on the air.
Hello?
Hello? You're on with the Captain and Dean Tong. Do you have a question?
This is Amanda.
Amanda, my dear. Dean, this is one of my parents that I work with. She has been a victim of CPS for several years.
Okay.
Her story is tragic just as much. Go ahead. What's your question for Dean, Amanda?
Well, I called in because I thought it was interesting the party was talking about where parents have been accused of sexual abuse. Well, when CPS first took my kids away, they had them for about 6 months. And when they took my kids away, they took them because of something that was going on with me. It really wasn't because I was doing anything to my kids. But then 6 months after they had my kids, they come to my door, and it's my social worker that had been on my case with a new caseworker, social worker, whatever. And they asked, can they come in and talk to me? And I said, yeah, because, I mean, the damage had already been done. They took my kids. And they came in, they sat down, and it was an investigative worker that was with her. And I sat down and, you know, I asked them why they were there, and the new worker spoke up and she says, well, I'm here to investigate about an allegation. I said, an allegation? I'm like, what do you mean? And she's like, well, she said, in interviewing your child, she said, it's come to my attention that he has been involved in sexual abuse. I said, excuse me? She said, yes, sexual abuse. I said, no. I said, my kids have never been sexually abused. And she's like, well, that's not what he told me. I'm like, right. I don't know what he told you.
Let me stop you right there. What state are you in, Amanda?
I'm in Kentucky.
Okay, so I've tenured and testified as an expert in Kentucky before. In Kentucky, it's called the CHFS, the Cabinet for Health and Family Services.
Right.
That's CPS in Kentucky. But like every other state, first of all, let me define what hearsay is. Hearsay, Captain, I'm not a lawyer, so let's get that straight right now. I can't give legal advice. I can give practical advice, but I'm not an attorney. I'm not a member of the bar. I'm not an officer of the court. With that said, hearsay, by definition, is an out-of-court statement made for the truth of the matter asserted. According to the law, hearsay, generally speaking, is legally inadmissible. However, the exception to the hearsay rule, one of the exceptions, is the child victim outcry or disclosure. So when the child tells a professional, child protective investigator from CHFS, therapist, guardian ad litem, psychologist, medical doctor, nurse, I was touched down there, that is legally admissible. Now, the law says that hearsay has to contain an indicia of reliability and an inherent degree of trustworthiness for the judge to basically rubber stamp that hearsay as being bona fide and trustworthy. Okay? That's up to an expert like myself to decide, okay? That's where a lawyer would have to employ an expert such as myself or a PhD psychologist to go over the forensics in the case, the CHFS intake reports, the allegedly sexually abused child's DVD forensic interview at the Child Advocacy Center. So I'm the guy that determines whether the hearsay is bona fide, if it contains reliability, validity, and trustworthiness, or if it's tainted, contaminated, and adulterated. That's for me to say. So I'm basically doing the work for the judge, who then can pick it up and rule and can make an order consistent with Rule 704. If you Google Federal Rule of Evidence 704, which is the ultimate issue. So the ultimate issue is for the fact finder to say. Only the judge or jury can say that the child is credible, that the child has been sexually abused or not. Okay, I can lay the foundation that the child's hearsay is trustworthy and reliable, or because it wasn't made spontaneously, because maybe the kid was coached, or CPS used flawed techniques and protocols to interview the child, leading questions, suggest questions, then the hearsay is contaminated or tainted.
Right. Well, see, she came to my house and she said that was the allegation, and she said that it had been told to her. Well, then she explained to me what he said, and I said, oh, okay, well, now I know what you're talking about. She said, well, he said that he watched you and your daughter's father do it. And I said, okay, well, now I know what you're talking about. I said, we lived in the trailer, and I said, the trailer had a really small hole in the door. And I said, we hadn't realized that he had been peeping through that hole, and we caught him doing it.
I get it. So it was just an inadvertent error on your part, that's all.
Well, see, we didn't know that you could see through it. I mean, it was just, I've never looked through it, and I didn't think about it, to be honest.
Right.
And we caught him looking through it. And when we caught him looking through it, we scolded him for it, of course, and he got sent to his room for that. And then we called our landlord and made him take the door off, change it out. So, I mean, we corrected the issue, but we had no idea how long he'd look through that hole. So I explained that to her. And I said, that would be the only way he would have ever saw anything like that. I said, I am not that type of person at all. And, of course, she talked to my daughter's father, and he told her the same exact story. Well, I didn't hear from them for 6 months after that about that incident. They left that case open for a year and never told me nothing else about it. It was just closed this year, back about 3 months ago. And my kids have been in foster care for 2 years. But they were seriously trying to charge us with that. And it's just crazy. They had, you know, I've been fighting for 2 years to try to get my kids back, and, you know, they have put me through so much, and Kenneth knows about a lot of it. And, you know, I've done everything they asked me to do. I worked my case plan, and they're using medical records and mental health records from way back when I was in foster care as a child as their reasons to terminate my rights in this case and adopt out my children.
Okay, so was your child adjudicated dependent? Did you consent to dependency, or did you lose at a contested trial?
I didn't consent to it. The attorney did it without my permission, and I fired her. And I hired me a private attorney, but because she did that, I couldn't do anything about it.
Yeah, so this is my point, Captain. When a lawyer, either with the client's knowledge or not knowledge, as in this case with Amanda, consents to dependency, signs the form, and then the client piggybacks by putting her John Hancock on the same form, it's basically an admission of guilt. When you consent to dependency, you're basically saying, I did it.
I didn't sign anything.
Well, then your lawyer signed on your behalf, but clearly there was an admission there. You did not go to a trial and present facts, witnesses, evidence, data, and science to impeach the allegations against you.
Right.
And that led to the child being lingering in foster care under the Adoption and Safe Families Act, the ASFA from 1997. CPS can come back and pick back, and after the kid's foster care for 15 to 22 months, they can file for TPR against your termination of your parental rights.
Well, see, the thing about it was I had everything they asked me to do done on my prevention plan in 3 months.
I get that, but then you have to have what's called a TPR trial, and you have to prove you substantially complied with their case plan. So, it's not what you know, it's not what you think you know, it's what you can prove in court. So the burden of proof goes from preponderance of evidence to clear and convincing evidence for CPS to terminate your parental rights, but clearly they can lie, they can cheat, they can do a number of things to say you did not jump through the hoops, you did not complete the performance agreement or case plan, and the judge can swallow that hook, line, and sinker and order TPR. And then you're left having to get another lawyer to appeal that to an appellate court.
Right.
So it just keeps going and going and going. Do they do that to keep the child? To me, it just seems to me. Now, I'm on the outside here, but it just seems to me.
Let's use our common sense out of the gate here, Captain. For one thing, most people in America, especially in today's economy, don't have the financial wherewithal to basically launch a Dean Tong counterattack and tell CPS, go to hell, I'll see you at trial. Most people can't do that today.
Right.
So most people have to spoon feed the case with their attorney and go along to get along just to keep from losing the rights to their kid. And you see Amanda, she's been in the system now for 2 years. So then the situation becomes the best interest of the child. The judge has to look at the stability and permanency. Well, the kid's getting along with the foster parents. The kid doesn't really want to see the biological mother anymore, who's been charged with failure to protect the father's sexual abuse. And of course, the foster parents are probably alienating the biological parents behind the scenes.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to get into. I have a lot of families, and like Amanda herself, where when they get into these foster care homes, they immediately try to separate the child away from the parent. So then when the parent comes to these visits, and when the child says, I don't like you, I don't want to be around you anymore, who are you? I mean, that's just got to be absolutely devastating to these parents, and
yeah,
I can't tell you how many.
All of a sudden, it goes from leave it to Beaver, make room for daddy, to you're a total stranger.
Right.
And they separate the siblings, even though they say they don't do that.
Yeah, they do. They separate.
This is why it's so critical to have a to have a very strategic and aggressive defense strategy and plan right out of the gate. Because if you play the let's wait and see what happens game, that's usually legal suicide.
Yep.
Right. But see, most of the time they go after families that can't afford, you know, to continue to fight, and they can't afford these specialized witnesses and stuff to come in on their behalf. They usually target people that can't afford it.
Let me get into that for a second, Captain, because, you know.
Yeah, go ahead.
I've had seven out of the 13 states I've testified in, you know, one of those being my own state of Florida, where judges have ordered the state to pay my fees as an expert. So why is that? Well, under Rule 403, under the 5th, 6th, and 14th Amendment rights to the U.S. Constitution, every accused individual who's facing jail time, loss of freedom, and or loss of parental rights of their children has a right to not only an attorney, but experts.
Okay.
So, you know, this is well published at my website. It has been for a long time. So people that are like Amanda, who are in juvenile court battling CHFS in a dependency proceeding, possible TPR, have a right to my services at no cost to her, where the judge will look at my CV, look at Amanda's right to due process and her need for an expert, I can give an opinion to a reasonably psychological scientific certainty on the witness stand. Her lawyer can't do that. All the lawyer can do is file motions, petitions, take depositions, go over direct and cross and redirect and recross in a court of law, and that's it. That's where it starts and stops. That's all the lawyer can do, argue the case in court. The lawyer can't get up there and give an opinion. The lawyer is an expert in the law, but not psychology, social science, behavioral science, mental health.
Right. Well, see, that's the reason they're wanting to terminate my rights is because, see, when I was in foster care as a child, I was molested and raped and I was beaten. And I ended up in behavioral institutes and everything because of it. And I was diagnosed with PTSD, anxiety, and depression because of it. And they're using those old records of depression that's over 16 years old, the anxiety not otherwise specified, and the depression, PTSD, and anxiety. They're trying to use that to say, oh, well, she's not a mentally fit parent, so therefore she cannot parent her kids. So they just going to adopt them out.
How old is the little girl now?
My daughter is 2 years old now, and my son is getting ready to be 14 in June.
So how old was the accusing child when the accusing child alleged sexual abuse?
Well, they dropped that case because they couldn't prove that. But when that came out, he was 12.
Oh, so it was the boy.
Right.
Okay. So was it your husband or your boyfriend or the stepfather accused of sexual abuse?
No, what it was is he told them that he had saw us have sex, that he watched us. And I explained to the social worker how that actually happened. And I never heard back from her on it. And when I finally was able to get a hold of her, she had done quit the cabinet and didn't work for them anymore. But she said, I'll close out that case. Well, when I called social services about that and told them what she said, they said, well, she don't work for us no more. And that case is still open. And it was just open until a few months ago this year. But yet they said it was found unfounded.
Okay, so if they dropped the sexual abuse, there must have been other allegations on the table as how they could keep the kid in foster care.
Well, like I said, I was adjudicated neglect on my daughter.
Oh, neglect, okay. And what was that about, medical neglect?
I missed a couple of doctor's appointments because my car was in the shop. It was getting the transmission rebuilt in it. And
okay.
I have paperwork to that fact that it was in the shop, and I even have paperwork drew up so that I could get special transportation for their medical through their medical cards.
So
have all that documentation, but yet they still charged me with missing those appointments, and they said, well, I neglected my mental health.
Your case broke in 2012, 2 years ago, correct?
Yes.
Okay, so let's say if hindsight was 2020, let's go back 2 years ago, and you hire Dean Tong, the guy you're talking to on the other end of this phone. So I would have recommended that you, the mother, go through a battery of tests to get a clean psychological bill of health.
All right.
And
well,
Let me finish.
Okay. Sorry.
So it just so happens, ironically, the number one psychologist I use in this country happens to be in Kentucky.
Okay.
Yeah. So this is the problem when clients and lawyers don't reach out to me. You know, I'm a guy with 30 years experience, not trying to toot my own horn, but I am published. I'm on Wikipedia. My website's approaching 900,000 hits. I've been hired in every state in America. There's nothing I haven't seen, and nothing I haven't faced in a court of law. And so, with all due respect to the attorney, I probably have done so many more cases than the lawyer has. It's not even funny. So this is where a lawyer has to eat his or her pride, put his or her ego on the table, and say, you know what, we need this guy. Whether you can pay this guy or not, I got to have the court do so, because we can't win this case without this guy.
Right. Well, see, CPS wanted me, this is the thing, before they come in and took my kids, Mr. Tong, I had a mental health evaluation done a year before they came and took my kids. And the people who did that, I've seen an actual psychologist with a PhD, and they evaluated me and said that I didn't need mental health therapy and I didn't need medication. So therefore, I wasn't going to mental health therapy or taking medicine for anything, because they said I didn't need to.
Well, no, this would not have been a mental health evaluation per se. This would have been a risk assessment. You would have been administered a battery of tests to basically show you're not the monster you've been painted to be. We probably would have done the same with the accused male as well.
Right. Well, I don't know. It's hard to explain it to you, but like what I'm trying to say is that they're trying to claim this is long-term mental health problems. But it's not. They said it was because I had went for so many years with inconsistent mental health therapy, and I hadn't been taking care of my mental health. But how am I supposed to take care of mental health if I'm told I don't have a mental health issue?
Well, and that's how you prove you don't, is by going through the risk assessment and having the psychologist, my doctor, my expert testify that, you know, there's no issues whatsoever with this woman. See, so that buttresses your credibility by having my expert clear you. But you didn't do that because you didn't think to do that, and obviously your lawyer didn't think to do that either.
Let me explain something to you so you'll understand me.
I understand clearly, ma'am. I've been doing this a long time.
Well,
probably,
I know.
Probably.
I'm trying to explain to you my situation.
The bottom line is you didn't hire any experts. The bottom line is your lawyer thought he or she could win this case without experts. Can't happen. Cannot happen without experts. They are as important. I'm not the only one in America, but experts are as important, if not more so, than lawyers in these cases.
All right. Well, see, CPS was wanting me to do a forensic psychological, but they wanted to pay for it. But the thing about it was, is my
You're not listening. The problem with that is you would have gone to the CPS prostitute or whore.
Right. Okay? Exactly. That's what I was getting to.
You wouldn't have gone to Dean Tong's expert, where you would have gotten an objective assessment of your mental health.
Right.
And that's what I was getting. That's a huge difference. And I hate to say, you know, this is the way it should have been, and it didn't turn out that way. But this is where parents have to get on the friggin' internet. This is why the internet exists. And we've had the internet now for almost 20 years in this country.
Right. Well, see, I've been on the internet for a long time, but I had never ran across you.
Well, you know, I'm out there. You Google my name, and there's probably 6 million hits on my name. So,
Amanda, I did put Dean's information. I also put the link, Dean, how to find a lawyer. I put that in the chat room. And don't worry, Amanda, we're in contact. I will send you that information directly to you. I've read through it. It is very good information. It's a very good website. It's very detailed, very complex. It's got a lot of information, and there's a lot to read on it. And it's quality information. It's not just, you know what I mean? It's quality information. So I will make sure that I get that to you, Amanda. All right. We'll go.
Yeah, I mean, I go up for termination in February, so it's really too late for me, but maybe it'll help somebody else.
I hate to say that, Captain, but it may be. I mean, like I just said about 15 minutes ago, clearly her kids have been in foster care long enough where CPS can go after her for TPR. You just can't wait in these cases. You can't. You give the government an inch, and they'll clearly take a mile.
Well, what is the, I guess, the time frame? Like, if they're in for a certain amount of time, obviously the chances of the children getting out of foster care are going to be so small.
The golden rule on that is 1 year. 1 year. Once those kids are in foster care for 1 year, your chances of getting them back just decrease by about 70%.
Wow.
But Mr. Tong, when they take your kids, they tell you if you work your case plan, you'll get your kids back. So that's what I did. I worked my case plan, but they never gave my kids back.
You know, with all due respect, Amanda, you and about a million other women out there and mothers in America, they say the same thing to in all 50 states. And these people will clearly tell you what you want to hear. Does that mean it's going to be executed? No.
Well, no, but that's what I'm saying. That's why people don't. I'm trying to put it in the right words.
Unfortunately, Captain, and here's the kicker. Here's the kicker with the attorneys. Because remember now, the attorney's the quarterback. The attorney's Tom Brady. I'm the running back. You hand the ball off to me, and I score the touchdown. The bottom line is the lawyer is the litigator. The lawyer is, excuse the pun, the captain of the ship. Okay? So when the lawyer tells Amanda, the client, listen, you got to go along with these people to get along. You want your kid back, you got to jump through their hoops, do everything they say, you'll get your kid back. Why? Because the lawyer has no clue on how to fight this. Or, if the lawyer does have a clue, he or she clearly does not want to do so.
Well, that's unfortunate. I see a lot of attorneys, it almost seems, especially court-appointed attorneys, do not appear, to me anyway, from all the mothers and all the parents that I've spoke to, they do not appear to be working for the client. They appear to be working actually for the CPS.
That's because they're underpaid, they're overworked, they're probably dealing with a caseload of 100 clients. The CPS worker is probably dealing with a case of 15 to 20 clients a month, 15 to 20 cases a month, which is above the national cap average. So I'm always dealing with 20 to 40 cases on my plate at any one time. The holidays, obviously, I'm going to be slower than not because people are not going to be spending their resources to go to court. They're going to be spending it on Toys R Us on their kids. My point is the lawyers have to you have to query the lawyer very quickly. Do you need help, counselor? Do you need help, counselor? That's the golden question that has to be asked very quickly in the case. If the lawyer says no, then the client has to basically defy the lawyer's advice, get on the internet, and contact someone like myself and say, listen, can you forward me your CV? I wanna send your CV to the lawyer because I think my lawyer is really playing me here. She says she doesn't need help, but I think she does.
I was going to ask you one more thing, and then I'm going to go. So if I had, per se, to have time to do this testing that you're talking about, and my attorney
I got to tell you, man, in your situation where your case is, legally speaking, from what I've heard, I don't think it'll help you. Your case, because you bypassed your right to a trial.
I'm having a trial.
What's that?
I'm having a trial.
Right, but the trial is basically for the hoops you've jumped through. Have you substantially complied with the CPS-CHFS case plan or not? That's basically the essence of your trial. I don't think the judge is going to allow one of my psychologists to run you through a battery of tests to show, you know, you couldn't have possibly done what you were accused of doing, whether it was neglect, abuse, or whatever. The time for that was like 2013, not now. Now
well, they're wanting me to do it now, but I can't afford it because it's like thousands of dollars what they're wanting me to do.
Well, you know, there's a legal Latin term. It's called informa pauperis, which means you're a poor person. Now, I don't mean that with disrespect, but I say that because the law allows in all 50 states for people who can't afford, like I said, to hire someone like myself as an expert or even a lawyer, a private retained lawyer. You have a right to a free lawyer, and you have a right to free experts. But to do that, you first have to file an affidavit with the court that where the judge finds you is called indigent for costs. So if you are indigent for costs, then the judge has to consider ordering the state to pay the expert's fees. And my fees have been paid for by Florida, Georgia, Alabama, West Virginia, South Dakota, Arizona, and Iowa.
Mm-hmm.
I've already testified as an expert witness in Kentucky. Back in 2009, I believe it was 5 years ago. But in fact, I remember the judge's name, Squire Williams.
mm-hmm.
I believe it was in Frankfurt. But the reality is I don't think the judge would allow testimony from an expert who would run you through a battery of tests or risk assessment at this point. You can ask your attorney if that's possible, but I sincerely doubt it.
Well, that's what they're wanting me to do now, but the CPS is wanting to pay one of their people to do it, and my attorney said no because he said that they always come out in CPS's favor.
Well, they do. They do. That's why I use the term, you know, prostitute or whore before, because that's exactly what happens here. Unfortunately, when CPS pays for the expert, the data can get skewed, and you can look very guilty. So,
right.
You know, my people are all down the 50-yard line, objective, independent, impartial, and neutral. Chances are you're not going to get that with CPS.
Right. Well, so that's what I was saying. If I talk to my attorney about filing what you just said about what I can't afford to pay the cost myself,
it's impossible to have it done. The first test in your case, because you're up for termination here in less than 60 days, is to file a motion for continuance. You would have to get your TPR trial continued somewhere into the summertime. If the judge is willing to do that. Judge may not be willing to do that. I don't know.
Okay. So how long would that type of testing take?
6 hours. Yeah, it's all day. You go through a mental status examination, a clinical interview, and the rest is all testing. So the testing lasts about 5 to 6 hours. The rest of it's about an hour to 2 hours. It's an all-day deal, like 8 hours.
Okay. So why would it need to be continued all the way up into the summer if it doesn't take that long to do it?
Well, because getting you approved by the court as indigent for costs, that could take 6 weeks. The lawyer has to file an affidavit on your behalf and then a motion for expert's fees, attaching the expert's CV to the motion as Exhibit A. That's a bureaucratic process. That could take the judge 4 to 6 weeks just to rule if you're indigent or not. So now you're already up to the time of your TPR trial. So, you know, and then, you know, so then once let's say the judge approved you as indigent for costs, then my expert has to be paid or at least get the court order that he's going to be paid. And then I don't even know if he'd be willing to do it on that basis. I do it, but I'm not a psychologist. I don't administer and interpret psychological test results.
Right.
you know, as far as raw data goes, I can critique other experts' reports. I've been allowed to do that as an expert, but I can't administer the test and then you know, write the expert report. I can't do that.
Right. Okay. Well, I'm going to talk to my attorney about that tomorrow and see what he thinks.
Yeah.
But if Kenneth, if you can get his information to me and things like that.
I'll get it to you. No problem, Amanda. I'll get it as soon as this show is over. It's in the chat room now, but I will send that over to you. I learned some more about your case that I did not know. But I want to appreciate you calling, Amanda. I really do, and hopefully some of the information that I'm going to give you, you know, might be helpful to you. So I really appreciate you calling, Amanda. We do have another caller waiting for a question. But first, Dean, I want to ask a question here that of a woman. I promised her that I would ask you this question. It's very concerning to her. If children are taken away, not permanently, but does CPS, do they have the right to go against the parents' religious beliefs as far as vaccinations, foster placement, or anything that goes against their religious beliefs?
Absolutely.
So they can, if your religion says no vaccinations or no this or no that, whatever it is, it doesn't matter. You are the ward of the state. They can do whatever they want, right?
Right, and they'll get their own experts to corroborate their belief system.
Okay, I'll get that back to her. I was hoping for a different answer, but I knew what the answer was going to be. You know, it's one of those kind of things. So. Okay, we do have another caller on the line. I don't have your name. I just have the last four numbers of your phone number. So if your last four numbers are 2377, you're on with the captain. Do you have a question for Dean Tong? Hello?
Hello?
Hello, you're on with the captain. Do you have a question for Dean Tong?
You bet you I do.
Okay.
Amanda Bulling.
Hi, Amanda.
No, this is not Amanda. This is an Amanda supporter.
Oh, okay. Do you have a question for Mr. Tong? Do you have a question for
Mr.
Tong?
There is no way and no how that she should have had her children taken away like that.
Okay, but do you have a specific question for Mr. Tong?
My specific question is, what does she do now? She
okay.
has national attention.
And I think,
she has national attention.
Right.
Okay,
well,
with all due respect, I've done about every national talk show in America. And it has helped a few cases, but in other cases, it hasn't made any difference whatsoever. So I don't know that that is going to affect the legal outcome of this case. In my professional judgment, what she needs to do through her attorney is to assert the proof and evidence at her TPR trial that she has substantially complied with the CHFS case plan. So if that means bringing in witnesses, whether they are lay, fact, or experts, there are three types of witnesses. You have lay witnesses, fact witnesses, and expert witnesses. You know, whatever the situation may be, at that trial, that's when her attorney, Amanda's lawyer, should be presenting evidence, facts, data, witnesses, testimony, science, to back up the fact that she has substantially complied with the CHFS case plan. Then, under the Adoption Safe Families Act from 1997, the lawyer can argue that it's incumbent upon the state to make reasonable efforts at reunification.
And you know what? I know she can do all that. And I also know a miracle for two sisters can do that.
Well, it has to be proved in a court of law. And even though the burden of proof is higher
the
for
law,
CPS.
The law? Hello?
Do you have a specific question for Mr. Tong? Something specific? I don't mean to be rude, but Mr. Tong, let's move on. I want to cover a couple of things here right now, and I understand where she was coming from. She's upset, and these parents are upset. They're angry. They're upset. They're confused, and
yeah. Let me just cover that for one minute, if I could, Captain. When CPS is getting ready to take a child from a family household, it's based on subjective discretion in real time of what that caseworker gleans to be imminent danger. So whether the child has no food, no shelter, no clothing, whether the child says she's been sexually abused, whether the child is visibly shaken with significant welts and bruises all over her body, I'm just giving you scenarios. It's subjective discretion real time that the caseworker is going to write in her notes and eventually in her report, in her affidavit, to support the petition for dependency, which will be championed by an assistant attorney general for the CHFS, a lawyer, counsel for the government. That's up to the caseworker in real time. So, and she only has to prove that by a preponderance of evidence. A preponderance of evidence is 51%. It's a very gray area. It's a very slippery slope. Okay? And CPS, as we all know, is a bureaucracy. They are this has been termed the child abuse industry. The child abuse establishment. In other words, CPS runs the courtroom.
Yes.
Judges are fearful of CPS. They don't want to upset the apple. They don't want to upset the apple cart.
Yeah, I found too. They take orders from these social workers.
You don't need a PhD in rocket science to figure out if you know ahead of time that CPS is David. Rather, is Goliath, and you're David, and they run the courtroom. It's going to take a very passionate and more so aggressive defense to counter the case being put on by CPS.
All right. Now here's another thing. We've been talking about a lot of lawsuits. Now, I asked this question, my first time I asked it. I've had several attorneys on here, Michelle Ryder's attorney, Randy Kretschmar. I've had several attorneys, and I've gotten several different answers. Now, there is a class action lawsuit going on in California right now. I don't know if you've seen, there was a Russian couple, and you've seen the police. They actually physically removed the baby from the mother's arms because she dared to ask for a second opinion because a doctor wanted to open up her infant, who was like 2 months old, I think it was, wanted to open up the infant's heart, tackled the father out in the front. But these class action lawsuits, now, are they really effective? How can they be effective? And to me, I don't know if it's possible, but it seems to me, instead of going just by state, that in order to really bring attention, I don't know if this can happen or not, but there needs to be a national class action lawsuit. And I don't even know if that's possible, but I mean, are these class action lawsuits, are they worth it? Do they have any significance?
Like you said, it's only going to be worth it if it's filed, number one, in federal court under 42 U.S.C. 1983 with the potential of getting to the U.S. Supreme Court in Washington, D.C. That's where you can really shake a tree and make some difference, is if it gets to the U.S. Supreme Court. As I alluded to earlier in this interview, I have a case pending in Alabama that's in litigation. It is a 1983 lawsuit in Alabama filed in federal court. And it has the potential of going all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court, if necessary.
All right. Well,
but just because it's a class action, because it has multiple plaintiffs, that doesn't mean it's any stronger than the single plaintiff lawsuit that I'm working on in Alabama. Just because it has multiple plaintiffs and it's styled a class action, it means nothing more than the case I'm working on in Alabama.
Right. Yeah, but I mean, it just seems to me at some point, And you're right. At some point, this has to go to the Supreme Court. I mean, what can the little guy like me, what can these parents do? I mean, is it going to take a collective effort to do this? Besides hiring, you know, people like you, I mean, eventually something's got to burst here. Something's got to burst.
I mean, for one thing, let's say Amanda got her kid back, and they reversed TPR, she got her kid back, and she wanted to file a suit. So let's say she filed a suit, she got a lawyer to file a civil rights complaint for damages in federal court under 1983. And the defendant's lawyers filed a motion to dismiss based on the fact that it's harmless error. The state took the kid, it's harmless error. So the judge finds out that Amanda, over the 2 years of losing her kid, was not in professional therapy. So the judge wants to know, look, Amanda, you've got to prove that the mental anguish, the depression, the pain and suffering that you suffered. I need expert proof. Did you see a psychologist? Did you see a psychiatrist? Were you prescribed antidepressant meds? I need the proof. The proof is in the pudding.
Well, I do believe that they forced her to, if I remember correctly, I do believe that they did force Amanda to take psychological meds. They forced her, and they told her that if you don't take these drugs, you can't see, you can never see your children, even on visits.
No, the one thing we haven't covered, Captain, whenever I'm hired and retained onto a case, whether it's a criminal case, whether it's a civil case, family, juvenile court, whatever, where your name is put on the child abuse registry internally by CPS, indicated or substantiated. I'm looking for a finding of fact and conclusion of law that the allegations against my client were false or unfounded. The only way that that's going to happen is if the accused goes through what's called an evidentiary trial, a trial on the merits of the case. And you know, welcome to Dean Tong time, because that's what I'm all about. All my cases go to litigation. All my cases are high conflict. All my cases are, this is a war, take no prisoners.
Right.
I'm not here to smoke the peace pipe. I'm not here to mediate. I'm not here to have drinks and be buddy-buddy. I'm here to do a job and get my client the equity at law that the client is seeking. If you've been falsely accused, by God, I'm going to help you assert that you know, your innocence in a court of law.
Wow. No, I appreciate that. I wish we had more of you. I really do. Obviously you don't, because, you know, it's your business. But, I mean, the amount of cases
there are times when I'm so overwhelmed, I could use the help. And you have no idea. I mean, right now I'm slow because it's the holidays, but there are times when I get so busy, I could use help. I could use a staff. I could use assistance. And you know, unfortunately, I'm almost 60 years old. And the problem with that is there's nobody coming up behind me in their 20s, 30s, 40s, or 50s who does what I do. And that's a real problem, because I might only make it for another 20 years on the face of this earth if I'm lucky. And then what's this country going to do? You know, and the reality is this problem is not going away tomorrow. It's not going away in It's not going away in 2016. It's not going away in 2020. And if Hillary Clinton is elected the next president in 2016, Houston, we have a real problem.
Yep. Now, this is not going to go away, for a long time. And as long as it's been going on, I had no idea. I had no idea. None of this stuff. And most of these parents don't. Nobody does. Even a lot of America. Now, I know they covered the Justina Pelletier case for, what, a week? You know, the mainstream media, and then they forgot about it. Nobody,
They didn't forget about it. They deliberately buried it, is what they did.
Exactly. And why is that? Why are the police? Why are the judges? Why is so many people so afraid of the CPS? What does the CPS have over all of these the law enforcement and judicial system?
It's Uncle Sam. It's Big Brother. It's Goliath. They don't want the apple cart upset. They don't want the wheels in motion to be upset. They want the money to continue to come in to foster parents who get stipends for taking kids, for the NCAN system to continue making money under the Mondale Act, the temporary assistance for needy families, TANF, to keep making their money. This is a hungry great white shark that has been out of control as long as I've been involved, 30 years. And great white sharks aren't going away anytime soon. So it's a feeding frenzy. And the frenzy is fed on families. Mm-hmm. And you got to know when there's a government allegation, the government gets involved, you better have the best defense team that money can buy.
Yeah.
And seriously, because otherwise you're going to wind up unfortunately, like where Amanda is.
Well, the government can change the rules anytime that they want to. They can change the laws. They can interpret the laws and the rules any way they want to. So you're right. It is, you're fighting Goliath.
This is a child protection system. It's not a family reunification system. That's not what its job is. Its job is not to reunify families. That's not what its intent is. Its initial intent, its only intent, is to protect children. And that's going to be its foremost goal. So if they're going to make a mistake, they're going to make a mistake on taking that kid. They're going to make a mistake on believing that kid, even if it's total hearsay.
Crazy. So, all right, it looks like we do have another caller. Now, again, I don't have your name. I just have the last four digits of your phone number. So if your number is 9685, you are now on with the captain. Do you have a question for Mr. Tong?
Hi, this is Molly Bowling. I have a question. Can CPS adopt my kids without my knowledge?
Not without your knowledge, but they can after TPR has been executed and signed by the judge. The next step would be legal adoption, ma'am, yes.
Okay, because my boyfriend's mother and his sister were, going to get my kids. But because my two older ones aren't biologically related to them, they couldn't get them unless they go through the foster care system, like classes and stuff. And I recently found out that they were asking both of them if they wanted to adopt my kids.
Okay. And these people are who to you?
They are my boyfriend's sister and his mother.
Okay. And I guess you'd be okay with that.
Well, I don't see why they would adopt my kids out anyways, is my question.
Like I said, if a judge orders TPR, termination of your parental rights, clearly the government has a right to move for adoption immediately.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Yeah, and they do so. And that's why I say, I tell all parents, when your kid goes to foster care, you're under an hourglass. You're fighting not just, CPS, you're fighting time. You're fighting the clock because now you're under the hourglass, and that hourglass is 1 year. If you don't get that kid the hell out of foster care within 1 year, you're going to lose that kid. It's very serious. They only give you two judicial review hearings, one every 6 months. That's it. So you don't get many legal bites at the apple here to turn this around.
Okay, and I also heard that you could open a court of records in, like, the family court system. Is that, good?
No.
Or?
Oh, no, you can't, because then you'd be doing what's called res judicata, collateral estoppel. You can't litigate the same issues in different courts.
Mm-hmm.
If people were allowed to do that, they would be doing it everywhere, and the courts, different judges will be hearing the same allegations in different cases in different courts. The law doesn't allow that to happen.
Okay. Thank you, then.
You're
okay.
Welcome.
Thanks, Molly.
Bye.
All right. Now, what have we not covered that we need to cover?
Well, we were gonna broach the actual forensic interviews of the children at the Child Advocacy Center.
Let's get into that.
And a lot of the people who are trained to do these interviews of kids allegedly abused are trained out of Huntsville, Alabama. And the website is nationalcac.org. Nationalcac.org.
CAC.org, okay.
Right, and they're out of Huntsville, Alabama. You'll see the website. And most of the interviews across America go through the training down there, which is about 9 hours from where I live in Tampa Bay, Florida. I've actually been asking to go through their training. They don't want me there because they know I'm the devil himself, according to CBS. I'm the guy they love to hate. And they don't want me in there just to find that they're screwing up these interviews, that they are using flawed methodologies and improper techniques and protocols. So they don't really want me there, but yet my money is as green as everybody else's, right? And it's not cheap. It's over $1,000 to go through their week of training to get their certificate of completion.
No, it's not cheap.
But my point is a lot of these interviewers are using a semi-structured methodology called RATAC, R-A-T-A-C. And RATAC allows leading questions. It allows suggestive questions. It allows some positive reinforcement. It basically allows for the interview to go awry and to become tainted and contaminated. And make no mistake, these interviewers with these little kids, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7, seven being the age of reason, where a child is supposed to understand right from wrong, truth from a lie, good touch from bad touch, from secret touch. These interviewers, you know, they're trying to get the desired responses from these kids that they want to hear, which is that you were touched improperly.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he fondled you. He touched your pee-pee. He touched your boo-boo, you know, whatever you call your butt.
Yeah.
You know, and so you know, they're not out to conduct witch hunts and fishing expeditions. They don't like that. They want to get positive results where their time and resources are spent, which means they want a victory.
Yeah, that's
well.
That's
on the defense side, being from Boston, I want a victory too, because I'm from Tom Brady land, where winning isn't everything; it's the only thing.
Exactly.
But the only way you get to the Super Bowl and win the Super Bowl is a team effort. It's not just Tom Brady; it's an entire team, right?
Yeah.
So this is what the client had to tell the lawyer. Excuse me, counselor, you can't pull this off by yourself. You need help. You need an expert.
Well, most of the cases that I, the families that I deal with, I've never heard of them ever having one expert. A lot of these cases, they go in and they're not even allowed to even speak. So, I mean, how do they bring an expert?
That's the initial hearing, Captain. Everybody like Amanda is entitled to what's called an adjudicatory evidentiary hearing or trial. Amanda chose wittingly or unwittingly to not go through that, and she basically bypassed her right to trial. So she gave up her right to due process. Everybody has the right to due process. Everybody has a right to their day in court. If you choose not to go through with your day in court, that's your subjective discretion. I don't recommend that. It's not what's published on my website. It's not what's published in my books. But if you choose to forego your trial and the right to prove a negative in your innocence, well, then you know you're going to get what's coming to you probably, which is you're going to lose.
Well, that seems like she was probably manipulated to lose.
I'm not going to use the verb manipulated, but let's just say she was confused and probably finagled by her lawyer to sign on the dotted line, or her lawyer sign on the dotted line for her.
And if you do this, this will happen over here, and everything will be, you know, you get on the boxcar, and everything will be fine. We'll take you to a nice, warm place. And, you know, we all know what happened there.
And unfortunately, during that meeting at the lawyer's law office, that client, whether it's Amanda or somebody else, doesn't have Dean Tong on speed dial. You know, let me call Mr. Tong and get him on the line right now. Because with all due respect, counsel, I need to get a second opinion here.
So it looks like we got a question from the chat room. It says, why aren't civil rights attorneys present at any hearing involving child placement?
Well, because first, like I said, you're going to have to get cleared in the court of law. You're going to have to get that finding of fact, conclusion of law that the allegations were unfounded or false. False would, actually be better, but unfounded would suffice before any civil rights attorney would even look at you, where you would have a clear cause of action upon which relief could be granted and file a lawsuit on your behalf. You first have to clear yourself. And then you can expose the negligence that led to the investigation that uprooted your life.
It just seems like
people that lose their kids, Captain, people that are in jail, Captain, they don't have a clear cause of action upon which relief can be granted. They're losing. You've got to be winning. To have a clear cause of action upon which relief can be granted. Then you go back through that civil rights attorney and you expose the negligence by the system that got you to the point where you were losing, but you turned it around to whereby now you're in a situation where the law allows you to sue.
So what? How many cases are
Here's a good example. A guy gets convicted of raping a girl. 20 years later, though, Barry Scheck's Innocence Project does a DNA test and finds out they got the wrong guy, mistaken identity.
I love that guy.
Okay. All right. So the black guy or the African American guy who was wrongly convicted for raping the girl, Barry Scheck's Innocence Project did the DNA. And they found out, you know, this wasn't the guy. You got the wrong guy. He's been in prison for 20 years. So the DNA has cleared the man, okay? That's the proof that the guy needed to conclude that he didn't do it. You know, maybe the girl was raped, but not by him. So now he can sue. He's been let out of jail. He's been exonerated. The DNA vindicated him. Now he can come back and sue the state for millions of dollars.
And nothing happens to her for the bogus, erroneous accusation and putting this
In my state, in Florida, under Florida Statute 39.205, subsection 9, it's a felony. You can go to prison in my state of Florida for launching malicious false child abuse allegations. A lot of that was because of me from 15 years ago, back in the 90s, when I lobbied the legislature here in Florida to make it a felony, and they did. Maybe to appease Dean Tong. I don't know. I don't really care. It's on the books. In most states, it's a slap on the wrist and it's a misdemeanor. That's another thing needs to be changed with the law. All 50 states need to be consistent and make it a felony.
I agree.
If you rape a kid and you're guilty, you're going to get life in prison or 25 years to life, right? So if you falsely accuse somebody, it should also be a felony. Maybe not as severe, but you should go to prison.
Oh, I totally agree, especially if the person spent 20 years, you know, of his life in a cage. So, and people's lives have been lost because of, erroneous accusations.
That was a jury's decision. That was a jury's decision to convict the guy. So you can't sue the jury. You can't sue the jury.
No. But the person who made the accusation, I mean, who got the ball,
the jury immunized the person who made the allegations by convicting the accused man.
Well, yeah, that is true. So
that's what happens here. So, you don't need a PhD to figure this one out. This is common sense. So when you're going up against the CHFS. Which is the Cabinet for Health and Family Services Child Protective Investigator or Social Worker in Kentucky, and you're going up against a police officer, and you're going up against a forensic interviewer, and you're going up against a child's therapist. You got four professionals all licensed right there. Seems to me you need an expert.
Yeah.
Seems to me that a lawyer by himself or herself is not going to be able to impeach the credibility of all four of those licensed professionals without having an expert.
Well, you know, it just seems to me that with all of the unemployed attorneys that we have out there, And it's not like people don't know what's going on with CPS now. And if you don't, I mean...
Well, yeah, if you don't, you're clearly living in a bubble.
Right. With all of the unemployed attorneys that they have out there, it just seems to me that this would be the kind of practice that, I mean, you've got an open field here. And you've got literally hundreds of thousands of cases that are immediately on your lap. Why aren't there a lot of attorneys getting into this? Are they afraid of the CPS too?
Well, yeah. Number one, it's politically incorrect. You're going up against the government, you know, and clearly lawyers, you know, they have drinks, they go golfing, they have lunch with the same lawyers they're going up against CPS. So you become known as that Dean Tong attorney that is litigating all the cases against them. You're going to be on their hitman list.
Oh, so you won't be able to, you know, play golf with them anymore, join their country club, have the party.
You're not going to be well liked. I mean, you're taking the bread and butter right off their table. So obviously,
well, they're taking the bread and butter out of the American taxpayer, because that's where that money's coming from.
I get it. But remember, this is a child protection system. It's in loco parentis, parents patriae. The state as the parent. The state, Hillary Clinton, it takes a village, believes that Washington, D.C. and all the states are better parents than biological parents, even though Santosky v. Kramer, Stanley v. Illinois, Franz v. United States says differently, that parents need to be proved unfit in a court of law by a judge before they lose their parental rights. This is the way it works. So, you know, with all due respect, you can't screw around with this stuff. This is lethal, and yeah. It's kind of like oil and water. It doesn't mix. When you have an attorney representing a falsely accused, and the lawyer is as naive or unwitting as the social worker is on the other side of the case.
Right. Well, this is a $12 billion industry. $12 billion. I knew that it was a lot of money. But...
No, sir. It's a lot more than that. I don't know where you're getting that number. But my state alone is $4 billion a year.
Well, I got it from a reporter. The other day.
It's a lot more than that. I would say it's well over $100 billion.
Oh my Lord. I had no idea that it was. I had no idea that it was even a billion. And now I went to 12 billion, and now I'm over 100 billion. Unbelievable. No wonder we don't have any money to get a veteran a doctor anymore. They're taking it all for.
If you go back to my first book published in 1992, Dr. Ralph Underwager wrote the foreword. Dr. Underwager died about 11 years ago. He was out of the state of Minnesota. His website is. IPT-forensics.com. But my point is, the foreword to my book, he wrote, Don't Blame Me, Daddy, if you took the profit away from the problem, the solution will go a long way towards correcting itself.
I think it would be corrected virtually overnight, but here's my only concern with that. Well, I don't know if it's a concern or not, but it just seems to me, I mean, they see a real abused child, they do these drive-bys, because I think they're probably of their own life, that if they try to take away this child, they're going to get abused themselves. But
well, the national statistic, Captain, on false allegations are somewhere between 2 and 9%, with the median being about 5%, okay? That doesn't include the other 70% or so that are unfounded. Okay, you alluded to that much earlier in this interview. So my point is, social workers by and large suffer from what we call a psychology confirmatory bias. They have a preconceived notion based on the heinous, reprehensible nature of the allegations the kid's been abused.
Right.
So they're immediately out to corroborate and validate the allegation, and they become what we call child savers, validators. Okay. Instead of examining and exploring multiple hypotheses and perhaps another reason for why the kid is saying what she's saying, they immediately rubber stamp and start treating the kid as a de facto victim.
Well, I do know that the CPS, there's a lot of pressure on these investigators that if they, I don't know if they've got a quota, but I do know that there's a lot of pressure on these investigators that if they don't take away the child, they lose their job. And if
there may be something unwritten behind the scenes between the CHFS worker and her supervisor. I wouldn't doubt that. There's clearly nothing in their policy and procedure manual, because when I get hired onto a case, one of the first things I have the lawyer do for me as an expert, the lawyer usually doesn't think about doing this, but I have the lawyer do it for me, is to subpoena the standard operating procedure manual or policy and training manual of CPS. Clearly, what you just alluded to is not published in the same, that the worker is getting a bounty or commission or royalty based on a number of positive cases. She's put in foster care or therapy or whatever. But I wouldn't doubt it. I wouldn't doubt it behind the scenes between the worker and the supervisor.
Right. I mean, they're not going to admit it, but there is a certain amount of pressure that if an investigator goes out to 10 homes or 20 homes, whatever the number is, and
it's not going to look good for the investigator if she's investigating 15 cases a month and 12 of those 15 come back to be false or unfounded.
Well, she could actually be doing her job, but I mean, to them, unless you're taking kids away from the parents, you're not doing your job.
It's not going to look that way when those statistics go to child maltreatment and NCANs under the Mondale Act, what I referred to earlier in Washington, D.C., when they get those statistics, it's not going to look good for the state, because they're going to have very, very few substantiated cases, most of the cases being unfounded.
We're running out of time here, but I do have a couple more calls, and these calls are important. So let's take another call here. Again, I don't have your name. I just have the last four digits of your phone number. So if your last four digits are 3000, you are now on the air with the captain. Do you have a question for Mr. Tong?
Hi, my name is Cassandra Brown. My twins, Ariana, Dominic, Luddington, were kidnapped by DCFS. My question is, how is it that the medical field are still diagnosing infants with shaken baby syndrome, but it's proven that the test was only done on monkeys? I'm just joining into the show. However, my infant, Ariana, was never had any neck injuries.
I don't know if you have to have a neck injury. You said your case is in Virginia, ma'am?
I'm in Illinois.
Illinois, okay. So basically, shaken baby, the two telltale signs are subdural hematoma and bilateral retinal hemorrhages, bleeding in the eyes, pooling of blood in the eyes. Those are the two telltale signs. Anything else like fractures, neck injury? I mean, that's just gravy. But those are the two telltale signs. When they get a little kid and comes in and is bleeding on the brain, subdural hematoma. There's bilateral retinal hemorrhages, pooling of blood in the eyes. Bingo. It must be shaken baby, especially if the accused is a boyfriend or a stepfather, not the natural bio dad.
You don't consider medical information from the beginning of birth?
Oh, sure. I mean, I'm an objective expert, so you're gonna be looking for viruses. You're gonna be looking for possibly osteogenesis imperfecta, other sources that could be causing the signs and symptoms that the baby is suffering from besides shaken babies.
My infants were born with IUGR, vitamin D deficiency, and were 5 weeks premature. I was given ciprofloxacin the first few weeks of conception because I wasn't believed to be pregnant. Does ciprofloxacin have any dangerous effects on the first week of conception?
Ciprofloxacin, is that what you're saying?
Ciprofloxacin?
Ciprofloxacin.
No, ciprofloxacin.
I've never heard of that one, but I'm not a medical doctor. All I know is that in your case, from what you're describing, clearly your attorney should have retained a pediatric geneticist or endocrinologist or some type of specialist to be able to articulate the findings with the baby when she was a neonate.
Okay, I understand. I agree.
Again, you need experts, and lawyers, unfortunately, lawyers are gun-shy to work with experts. I don't know why that is.
I have one medical expert, but I still need a bone density expert.
Mm-hmm. Sounds right to me.
All right, thank you.
Okay. Thanks for calling. We got time for one more call, and then we are running out of time. So, again, I don't have your name. I just have the last four digits of your phone number. If it's 0925, you are now on the air with the captain. Do you have a question for Mr. Tong?
Yes, I do. My name is Reverend Rosemary Dalton.
Okay.
And about 17 years ago, the courts decided to have fraud upon the court, and that I can prove. They took my child in protective custody because he broke his arm. The police did a full investigation and exceptionally cleared of any abuse and any wrongdoing. Two specialist doctors said it was more logical for it to happen by the way it was explained than what the ER doctors say, and the ER doctor recanted his statement. DFS then was supposed to close the case because the prosecutor refused to press charges, so no criminal charges was made. Then they took my child and terminated my parental rights with no evidence of any abuse of any kind to that child or any other children that I had. They had no evidence of any drug chemical dependency, no evidence of any mental health issues, and the only reason they terminated it was because I didn't pay maintenance support that I was not court-ordered to pay. And then they sealed my file and refused me any documents, no discovery. They would not allow me to testify. They would not allow my lawyer to do anything, and they made my lawyer quit and then issued me a court-appointed during the thing. And we tried everything we could, including recusing the judge for prejudice because I could not get a fair trial. I tried everything, and now they got my case so sealed that they will not let me do anything with it.
Who was the accused, ma'am? Not you. A man was?
My husband was. He's a stepfather, and he was exceptionally cleared.
They were trying to get you for failure to protect?
They tried, and that didn't work either. They tried, said I was in denial, but how can I be possibly say yes, it happened, if the police and the full investigation that they exceptionally did, and I mean, it was detailed.
Apparently, with all due respect, it did work because they TPR'd you. So whenever you get a case like yours, I tell clients, unfortunately, the woman is joined at the hip with the man. If the man is cleared, the woman is cleared by proxy. If the man goes down, you're going down too.
But he didn't get charges, none. And he wasn't even on my case. They took him completely off the case. He wasn't even involved in the family court proceedings at all.
Well, there's a different threshold of evidence between criminal court and civil court where your parental rights are being terminated. To start a TPR case only requires a preponderance of evidence, 51%. Criminal court...
There was no evidence at all. It says it was selling the TPR.
Well, they had to have something to
That stated exactly what the TPR said.
You know, in order to get the TPR, you first have to have an allegation. That allegation has to be investigated. You either have to lose a trial or consent to dependency. The child is clearly going to be adjudicated dependent to get to a TPR.
Well, I understand that. We tried. The judge already didn't even look at the file. They ruled on it 3 weeks before my trial. The judge
did.
It's signed.
What state were you in?
Missouri, St. Louis.
Missouri, okay. So that's DFS?
Yeah. They lied. They fraudulently said all kinds of things. And the lies are right there. I mean, they contradict themselves one right after the other. Constantly. One page will say this. Another page will say something totally different. There's constantly lies. Violations out the yin yang, you name it. And I tried everything I could trying to fight for my civil liberties. My lawyer got told they were going to disbar him. He got fired in the middle of it. I didn't fire him. They did. He says, you need a good appellate lawyer, and then no lawyer will touch it. They blacklisted me here. No legal community here will touch my case. Ever.
Well, you know, and this is why I'm so important on cases, Captain, because, you know, as I've said about 10 times in the show, I'm out to win and win at all costs. And oftentimes I'll do the work of my own work, and I have to do the work of the attorney also. So if I have to bring a lawyer in from out of state, what's called pro hoc vice, then I will do so. I don't play the local politics games with the attorneys. If the case is in Kansas City or St. Louis, Missouri, I'll bring a lawyer in from Kansas, or I'll bring a lawyer in from Tennessee, or wherever I have to bring a lawyer in from, I'll do it to win. You know, and you know that's why it's kind of ironic, because I'm getting one fifth of what the attorney's getting, compensated monetarily speaking.
And you're doing all the work.
But I'm doing most of the work. That's correct.
Right. Yeah. Well, I appreciate your call. We are running out of time. I just got the cue. Thank you very much for calling there, the caller. Hopefully, we might have been able to answer your question. But Mr. Tong, again, sir, I can't tell you how appreciative I am, and I know a lot of the listeners are. I really appreciate your work. I wish there were a million others just like you. Hopefully someday, maybe somebody's listening right now and they might want to go into this field, and maybe we can try to win a few more of these cases. So.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind having one or two under my wing eventually.
I find myself inundated too. I mean, I get calls. I mean, people are calling me. These parents are calling me in the middle of the night. I mean, as soon as I get up in the morning, I mean, my God, I've got a stack of stuff, my desk.
First of all, you got to understand, as a lawyer or as an expert who is working these types of cases against the police and CPS in juvenile/criminal court, family court, you're going to get a volume of discovery that is unbelievable. I mean, some of my cases have been four or five, six banker's boxes full. Four or five, 6,000 pages of discovery. You got to be able to roll up your sleeves and do the work. You got to have thick skin. You got to have thick skin. You got to be politically incorrect. And you got to be an immovable object. Understand this: when I'm on the witness stand and I'm going up against a lawyer for, say, DCS in Tennessee, I'm going up against that attorney for the government, DCS. I'm going up against the guardian ad litem, who's also an attorney. I'm going up against the attorney for the opposing parent. So that's three lawyers. And I might have to go through five volleys of cross-examination and recross-examination. So oftentimes I'm on the witness stand for 6, 7, and 8 hours at a time. Grab your popcorn and enjoy the show, because it's America versus Iraq time.
Unbelievable. Okay, I've got less than 20 seconds. Again, Mr. Tong, I really appreciate you coming on this program. I really do, and I look forward to hearing your name in the news of winning another case. Ladies and gentlemen, we will be off for the next 2 days, and we will be back here on Friday at 8 p.m. A happy New Year, everybody. We'll see you then. Bye-bye.